Well, good morning. Good to see you this morning. Glad you're here. Want to welcome you. Want to remind you, if you have prayer needs or concerns or requests, share them with us on the index card on the center of your table. And again, just want to welcome you this morning on this cold, cold winter. I think there's some hope for spring this week, so we just pray in that direction. Got some announcements. We have lots of things going on in the life of our church, and today is Love Your Church Dinner, so you want to show up, just be here at 4 o'clock, and we've got food and activities and games and challenges and just a lot of fun. We get together and we just celebrate life together, doing life together. So we look forward to this afternoon at 4, so it's in the Big 8, so you just all come and look forward to having you here. We have word for today. March is coming, so that is on your table. There's some everywhere else as you come in the church, so please take a couple with you, share them with a friend or a neighbor, drop it in somebody's mailbox or something. Do something evangelistic with it. It is the best devotional there is, and so I just want to encourage you, take one with you today and take one for a friend or a neighbor. March Mission Madness on your table also are little flyers, just really little reminders. And there's also Save the Date on your table as well. So those are to go with you, to put those things on your calendar and be a part of all the things that are going on in the life of our church. So March Mission Madness is our big fundraiser. We do that annually, and that is on March 6th. So there's incredible prizes. There's $1,000, a $500 cash prize, and then there's just silent dessert auctions and great fun things for kids to bid on. And if you've not come to it, you've got to be there, and you've got to invite some family, some friends, and all the proceeds go to our summer missions, which we are on the move this summer, so I'm so excited about that. So we need like some donations, your gift certificates or homemade items, or if you're crafty, and just share them with us and let us know what you're going to donate. And we look forward to seeing just a great, great time on March Mission Madness. Doors open at 2 o'clock till 5 o'clock. And so you come and you circle the buildings and you check out everything. And then we start pulling all the tickets at 6 o'clock. And no, yep, 6 o'clock. Yep, 6 o'clock. And then we're usually done about 7, 7:30, so you can join us live stream, or you can join us here in the house. We're looking forward to that. So it's a lot more festive if you just show up and join us and holler for the people who are winning. And then you can pick up all your prizes by 7, 7:30. If not, we'll keep them for you, so you don't have to be here to win. Just so you know, Lent begins on March 2nd. So I don't know if you're a Lent kind of person that gives up things for Lent, prepares for those 40 days before the resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord, but I just want to cue you that March 2nd, Ash Wednesday, is coming close. And for us, for our church, we use the season of Lent to pray for and also construct an offering for abolishing human trafficking, slavery. So we just want us to all be prepared about that. And then we know Easter is coming, and that's the 17th of April, and then the 15th of April is our Good Friday service. Women's retreat is happening at Watermarks, April 29th through 30th, so you can sign up in the back for that. And Anchors Watermarks Day is happening on May 7th. I know it's a little far out there, but we want to get on your calendar. So please, Anchor students, sign up for that. And VBS sign up. We're looking for loads of helpers because we need loads of helpers. So you can go ahead and look at that date and come and join us and help. And that is our big summer outreach mission for our community. I think that's that's about all the announcements I have this morning. Again, just want to welcome you. Jacob Shiflett was going to lead us in worship, and they changed his weekends at Watermarks, and so he's coming to us to help us worship this morning via video. So let's stand and say hello to one another, and let's prepare to worship God this morning.
Service. I hope this worship cuts it. Maybe it doesn't make sense. So let's get worship.
God. Step down to earth, an innocent perfection.
into your presence. And this morning we just ask that you would speak to us, that you would touch us, that you would move us, and that we would respond, that we would feel your Holy Spirit, be captured by love, embraced by the power of your promises in your word. Be your church, be your family, be your people on the move, following where you lead, trusting in you in all circumstances. God, abide in the gathering today. We lift up your name that you would be glorified and that all the world would come to know you as Lord. We pray for those this morning who are not with us, those who are sick, which are many, those who are traveling, those who just have coming against stumbling blocks and obstacles. God, we just ask for your mercy and we pray. We pray that you would pour it out in their direction and ours this morning as we gather. We love you, Lord. We lift your name up high. In Jesus always we pray. Amen. I just want to do some prayer updates. I got a text from Brian this week. I didn't know, or I don't follow news so much. And Guatemala had an earthquake, and he asked if our friends were okay. So immediately I texted our mission serve leader, and he said, yes, everyone was okay. A few houses tumbled, so we're just so grateful for that. So we praise God for that. And then I got another call this week, and many of you may know or have had relationship with the Kirby family, Glenda and Dale Kirby. They were just ever-present fixtures in the life of Effort Baptist Church in Palmyra, and Dale died Tuesday. He had some complications from a surgery, and so we grieve the loss, and we just want to pray for presence and peace and comfort for Glenda, his wife of 47 years, I believe, and his two children. And so there is a family gathering visitation at Effort's Family Life Center this Tuesday at 1 o'clock. And the celebration service of life is at 2 o'clock. So 1 o'clock, you can come and visit the family, and 2 o'clock is the service. So I just want to share that with you as well. We want to pray for those who have gotten the virus, the stomach bug, and it just seems to be crippling many. Inside and outside of our family community. So we just wanna pray for them. And so thankful for my kids' recovery in process as we speak. So just wanna ask you if you have concerns or silent prayers, that as we pray and as we take an offering this morning, we wanna lift them up to the Lord. So would you join me in that undertaking? God, you are great, you are good, your love is so embracing, so powerful. Your love changes everything. It changes us. We want to be about our Father's work, and so we give to you an offering this morning. We give back just a little bit of the blessings and gifts and resources that you've entrusted to our care. And in so doing, Lord, we pray for friends, family members that are sick, that are struggling. Thank you for protecting our brothers and sisters in Guatemala, God. We lift up the Kirby family in their time of mourning and sorrow. And we just ask that many arms would just embrace them, wrap arms around them, and our prayers would lift them up and give them comfort and peace in these days, Lord Jesus. We continue to pray for Jackie and Lee and for their housing situation and disposition. Lord, we just ask for favor in their direction. We ask, Lord, for our church as we are on the move, on the way, all the time. We just want to continue to follow where you lead and be about advancing the kingdom in our lives and in our community, in our nation and in our world. We pray for our nation and its leaders, Lord. We pray for wisdom. We ask that you would just equip and empower, raise up your people who are in leadership positions. We pray for their protection. We pray for their voice. We pray for their decision making. God, our nation needs you, God. We need the Lord, and we need Christ followers to lead and guide in an upward and godly and good direction. Please help us, Lord, not that we deserve it, but because we pray, because we believe with you, all things are possible. You are an unstoppable God. And so we pray for your will to avail against all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Stacy come in late this morning. We are a late church. Folks. We're a late church, aren't we? Well, a lot of people came.
After in memories, and it made me so grateful to be able to take the time to do that with my family. Tonight is our Love Your Church dinner, and that what we experienced yesterday is what it's all about, taking time to spend time with our church family to create memories and to just enjoy being together. So, since we already had the offering, I'm not going to bless it, but we'll say a little prayer. All right, I'll bless it shortly. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this church, this wonderful group of faithful followers, and for all the blessings you provide. Father, thank you for our day yesterday, for the Hamill family. It was time that we all needed together. And Father, I ask that you bless our event this evening with joy, with laughter, with smiles, and I hope we make a lot of good memories together. I also ask you to bless today's offering. Please help us use it to spread your story and glorify your name. We love you, and it's your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. There's also good food this afternoon, so be a part of that. Well, it was quite a week. I don't know for you. Super Bowl was just 7 days ago, right? And then Valentine's Day was on the next day, Monday. And then Monday night, my three-year-old preschool teacher, her water broke and delivered her beautiful baby girl this past Tuesday morning. 3 weeks early. God told me, I've been saying it, I was prepared, but not that prepared, not 3 weeks. So Olivia Hammond and baby were healthy and doing great, but she was supposed to have her teacher orientation this past week. Oh, and then the stomach bug ran through our preschool building, taking out children and staff everywhere this past Thursday and Friday. Susan, you're alive. Sam called out, he was sick as a dog. I was like, oh my gosh, just help us make it, and he did. Because half our kids were sick, and so half of our staff was sick, so we had great ratios. But it was crazy. I'm not sure what kind of week you had, but it's always good when it's Sunday and we gather together to glorify God in his presence and be present with one another. There's no better place to be on Sunday than here. And we can just let go, we can rest, we can take in God's peace and invite joy to abound in our lives. Our winter message series, I hope you know it by heart, is called Holy Spirit Activate. And I have to show you what my daughter got for me to wear today. Isn't it? She didn't do it on her Cricut, but she didn't have time. But she found it, of course, on Amazon. Holy Spirit Activate, and it's glittery too. So it's just so awesome. And what a better day to wear it than on Love Your Church dinner day. Maybe the TikTok phenomenon has now worn off about Holy Spirit Activate, activate. But they probably moved on to something now, I'm sure. But I really hope we retain the slogan and the power that's generated when we invite, when we ask, when we join the Holy Spirit's activity in our life, in our circumstances, in our situations. So, Holy Spirit, activate us this morning in giving and receiving the message that God has for us. The sermon title for today is, Am I My Brother's Keeper? Is that phrase familiar to you? Let's read the genesis of that familiar quote. Huh? Let me catch that. In Genesis 4, verses 1, I guess not. Go to Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. Genesis 4, 1 through 16. Now, Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I produced a man with the help of the Lord. Next she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a tiller of the ground, a farmer. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel, for his part, brought of the firstlings of his flock their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said to Cain, Why are you so angry, and why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted, recognized? And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you. But you should master it. You must master it. You should not open the door. Cain said to his brother Abel, Let's go out in the field, brother. And when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, Where is your brother Abel? And Cain said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it will no longer yield to you its strength. You will be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, My punishment is greater than I can bear. Today you've driven me away from the soil, and I shall be hidden from your face. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and anyone who meets me may kill me. And then the Lord said to Cain, not so. Whoever kills Cain will suffer a sevenfold vengeance. And the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one came upon him would kill him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. So for whatever reason, God preferred the offering from Abel over the offering, the sacrifice of Cain. And there is an innuendo that if Cain's offering demonstrated him doing something well, then he too would have been acknowledged. That offering would have been received. But this rejection that took place, or maybe this jealousy that stirred up, made Cain extremely angry. And this anger resulted in sibling conflict out in the field, and ultimately Cain ended up killing his brother. When God asked Cain the whereabouts of his brother, Cain responded with this familiar quote, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Although God did not answer Cain's question directly, the consequence for Cain's action was quite clear. Cain's sin, not keeping care of his brother but killing him, meant Cain was cursed. Cursed from the ground where his brother's blood was shed. The curse meant that his trade, Cain's trade as a farmer, would no longer be productive. And Cain is banished from a fertile land to a surrounding desert area. But God still extended grace by giving Cain a mark that would protect him from being seen as a fugitive and having permission to be killed by others. Cain came to know the answer to his question, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Yes, yes, you are your brother's keeper. But Cain had to learn it the hard way. God does call us, expect us to be our brother's keeper. I got a letter, an email this week from a young medical student that we worked with for the very first time on our Liberia mission trip, and I just want to share it with you. "Hi, Rev. June. Hope you're doing fine. I hope everyone is doing fine and the church is good. I want to appreciate you and the entire team for the job done in Liberia. I highly appreciate you guys for the token and gifts given to me. I am indeed grateful. Finally, I will be taking my oath as a medical doctor on February 26th and to be followed by graduation on March 8th. I'm so grateful to God. I'm highly inspired and motivated by the work you guys do. Dr. June," I'm not a doctor. "Dr. I act like it in Liberia and sometimes Guatemala and sometimes in preschool. But Dr. June, hence I have become more interested in mission work. It has always been my dream that one day after my medical specialization, I will go into mission work and focus more on using my medical knowledge and skills to reach out to the lost and win souls for Christ. I become so interested in mission work, and I strongly believe that God has a plan for me. I highly appreciate it if you can share with me some materials, books, lessons, etc., that will help me prepare for this task. Again, I want to say thanks to the entire team for the inspiration, and it's my fervent hope that God will continue to strengthen you guys to do more. Am I my brother's keeper? Yes. I had no idea I would meet this brother. I had no idea a medical student would be inspired and encouraged because he tapped into a couple days of doing medical mission with us in Liberia. When the Holy Spirit is given permission to activate in our life, when we say yes to God, when we sense he's leading, he's prompting, he's stirring up something in us, and we answer the invitation, we just say yes. We're just obedient to follow or lead or give or pray or help or go. We're being obedient to God's will. We are keeping our brother, caring about our brothers. I told you last week I delivered the bags that our AIMS students assembled in our youth group for the homeless men in Pacham. We went to a church in Charlottesville. And well, this week I delivered the bags for the women in Pacham at a hotel in Charlottesville. We always used to go to churches. Women were housed in churches like the men over the winter time. But now the women's shelter during the winter was at a hotel in Charlottesville, and the hotel is right there on 29. And as I went into the lobby, it says, "We are no longer a hotel," and it was really pretty rough looking. And it's divided, the woman told me, into three areas: the Pacham shelter year-round for men, and Pacham shelter year-round for women. But then there's a temporary shelter for women, and that's the place that we were going to drop off the bags. And she said that the women there would be so grateful, so blessed by the bags that I delivered. But I couldn't but ask, are there some specific things that maybe we can do for the permanent residents that are here year-round? And she didn't hesitate for a moment. Yes, full double bed sheets and blankets. I could almost hear the Holy Spirit tell me to ask her that, because I know the answer to Cain's question. You and I are our brother's keeper. I want to read a section of Paul's letter to the church at Rome. And the focus on the paragraph is really about not passing judgment on one another. I guess it was a problem for Christians even back then in the early church, or maybe it just has to do with our fallen human nature. But Paul is teaching the church how to treat and care for one another. So we're going to go take a look at Romans chapter 14, and we're going to start at verse 1 through 12. Romans, New Testament, chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. Welcome those who were weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while others who are weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before our own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, Saturday for Sabbath or Sunday for Sabbath. There was a little bit of quarreling going on about that, and food that had meat and food that had vegetables. But while others judge all days to be alike, let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe Saturday or Sunday, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in the honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it's written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. So the key verse in this section is verse 7. If you underline in your Bible, this is a great one to underline. Verse 7, we do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. One essential truth in Christianity is that in life and in death, believers belong to the Lord. And they belong to one another. We are children in God's family, and we have brothers and sisters all around us. Brothers and sisters that are in our blood family, we're genetically linked. Some we're connected because we're in God's family. Some brothers and sisters are just part of the human race that makes us connected. But we're all created by God, and we do not live to just ourselves. We're called to be our brother's keepers. Has it ever dawned on you that God has entrusted us, you and I, with brothers and sisters that need or just require spiritual help or care or attention? Are we just living to ourselves and we miss that there's other people out there that are hurting or lost or need some care or attention spiritually? Beautiful Gate got a letter of appreciation this past week. We sent 25 care packages to our servicemen and women this past November. 650 packages went out in the month of November. And they notified us, just got it this week, that they reached our packages as far as the Horn of Africa. One package that was sent reaches and is given to share among five servicemen and women. We were spurred on last Memorial Day by a testimony from Brian Archer. He's a Marine that did three tours of duty in Afghanistan. And back in Memorial Day, he gave us a video and he encouraged us to pray and to send packages for our brothers and sisters in the military because he knew their needs. He challenged us to be our brother's keepers. And we answered the invitation for the first time. We did military packaging. And we were part of 750 packages that were mailed out in November. What a blessing. When we're talking about keeping our brothers, we don't mean enabling somebody, rescuing somebody, or being codependent. If I'm sad, you're sad, or not losing our boundaries, not hurting, helping someone to the detriment of ourselves, but understanding that God has put us with some people, connected us with some people, maybe family or friends or coworkers or employees or neighbors, for a reason, for a purpose. We need to be aware and understand that God has put us in places, in situations or circumstances for a spiritual reason, for a spiritual purpose. Playing on a football team in the Super Bowl even has a reason and a purpose.
Cooper, I know you don't really like talking about yourself, but the moment after you won Super Bowl MVP, what was just going through your head of basically just your entire career, no offers, zero-star recruit, all, everything?
I wasn't really where my mind was. I was just looking at my family, looking at my wife, my boys coming out here. I think they've sacrificed. They've been through with me. They've encouraged me through. My wife's been with me since senior year in high school. She's been through all of it. She's seen it all. She knows the sacrifices because she's lived the sacrifices herself as well. I was just so, it's so amazing being able to see them while I was up on that podium. In 2019, we walked off the field that last time after losing to the Patriots. I wasn't able to be a part of that thing. I don't know what it was. There's just this vision that God revealed to me that we were going to come back. We were going to be a part of a Super Bowl. We were going to win it. And somehow, I was going to walk off the field as the MVP of the game. And I shared that with my wife because I couldn't tell anyone else, obviously, what that was. But from the moment this postseason started, there was just a belief. Every game, it was written already. It was written already, and I just got to play free knowing that you know, I got to play from victory, not for victory. I got to play in a place where I was validated, not from anything that happened on the field, but because of my worth in God and in my Father. And I'm just so incredibly thankful. I just, in that moment you're talking about, I just felt like I was just so undeserving of what that was in that moment, because it was, I mean, the people that I've been able to play with, the people that I've been around, the players that I get to play with, they're coming to work with every single day, the coaches that I get to work with, to collaborate with. It's just been just the perfect team, the perfect setup. I'm just so thankful for everyone that's been around me. It was, I don't know if it still really hasn't hit me.
How was that vision revealed to you?
It was just walking off the field. It was as clear as day. I walked off the field. I turned around before walking back through the tunnel, and it just hit me. It was as clear as I can see you guys here right now.
Cooper, he's
pretty incredible.
Can you walk us through your route on the winning touchdown, of what you're supposed to do on that play, the way you're trying to get leverage inside and then go outside?
Yeah, we had a little run alert in. You know, call the run. If we get the look we want to, we'll get man or something. We get a zero. I think we ended up getting a zero on that one. We're able to alert things, alert and throw a little fade ball out there. Eli Apple had been playing me pretty well the entire game. Really came up, challenged me. Doing a really good job with that. And he covered zero. He got that inside leverage, so I tried to just weave to his leverage, make him, you know, move in a little bit, jab him one time, and be able to just give Matthew some room to put the ball wherever he wanted to, and made a great, you know, back shoulder throw, and was able to come down with it.
Cooper, you had a really, for you, a quiet 2.5 quarters, 3 quarters, and then you went off, and so did the offense in the fourth. I'm just curious, you know, was it hard to stay patient knowing, hey, this is a Super Bowl, I'm trying to make a play here, and then ultimately you make the biggest play?
Yeah, no, it's really about just trusting your guys. I've said it all year, whatever's asked of me, whatever my job's going to be, you know, I just want to execute to the best of my ability. Sometimes it's run blocking, if we pass blocking, it could be just running to get someone else open, setting picks, whatever it is. I just want to execute my job to the best of my ability, and I trust that, you know, as the game goes on, I'll have opportunities as well, and I just want to stay ready for those things, stay locked in. You know, sometimes you're on the backside of a play, you know just based on coverage, the ball's not coming to you, but being able to work a good release, being able to work a good route, and have a little bit of recon to saying, you know, hey, when I come back to this, when it is time for the ball to come my way, I've set this DB up in this way, and you're just playing that game within a game.
Okay, I don't know one word he said, okay? I thought I knew football. I don't know anything he's talking about, but I heard something. I heard that he played from victory instead of for victory. And I heard that the reporter was absolutely curious and asked his first question about his vision from God. Cooper demonstrates that he's his brother's keeper. He's an incredible and humble witness to how we care for our family, his team members, his coaches. Here's a guy who had no college offers to start scholarships for football when he graduated from high school. But he said that the teachers he met at this school, at this college he attended, end up training him, building him up. It contributed all to his future and becoming the man and player he is today. God had a plan. We all have a spiritual calling to be our brother's keeper. It may be impacting a team, a coach, a member, a fan, maybe about a relative that's lost or hurting or confused. There are friends in school that may be different from us, maybe weak in their faith, or maybe have no faith. We could be our brother's keeper. We could say a kind word or give an encouraging look. And we ask for the Holy Spirit to invade us, to take over our situation. We are setting ourselves up to follow the prompting of the Holy Spirit, God's prompting, God's plan, and God can use every one of us to reach or touch or lead someone. There may be a brother, maybe a friend who just needs prayer or an invitation to church. It may be taking a risk and praying with some of your employees before the work on the job site begins. Maybe reaching out to a friend that you've missed seeing at church. It may be taking a step in another person's direction. It is God's answer to Cain and God's will for his church that we know and be our brother's keeper. What brother or sister is the Holy Spirit putting on your heart right now that you might help or reach or pray or invite this person in God's direction this morning? Let us pray. God, as we really invite you to put a brother or sister on our heart, I wonder if we've realized that a brother or sister has touched us or helped us, that it's not a one-way street, that we give and receive, and there's just joy in both. But we pray this morning, God, that your Spirit does prompt us, that it does activate us, that whatever scales or stumbling blocks prevent us from seeing or hearing or feeling your call and your invitation to care for another, that by your power and your grace, that you would remove it, that we would take a leap, that we would dare to move in the direction of another, because it's your will, it's your desire, and it's a glorious, beautiful thing to be part of the family of God. You use the church as your vehicle for salvation and redemption. May we, Lord Jesus, be an amazing part of that plan, that purpose, that reason that you give us life. We pray, Lord Jesus, this morning. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing and close with an invitation. And if you want to pray for someone, if God's put someone on your heart, if you're the one who needs prayer or encouragement, deliverance from anxiety or worry or depression, whatever the enemy is trying to purpose against you, that you're not free, that you're not liberated to follow where God's leading you right now in this time and place, then we're here to pray for you. So let's stand and worship together. And if you need prayer, come, we're here. Thank you. Great God's people. So come and enjoy and love your church dinner today. God bless you today. You are loved. Your acceptance, your presence has been received by the Lord. And the good news, that's an Old Testament story. And because of Jesus Christ, we are presentable before the Lord. May we be presentable to one another today, tomorrow, and all the days ahead. May we see one another the way Christ sees us. God bless you today.
Come on, people now. It's not only brother, everybody get together. Some may come in, some may go.